So I'd like to start out by asking why Zhang Peili decided to begin making video art. He was a student in the 1980s at the China Academy of Art, which was then known as the Zhejiang Academy of Art in Hangzhou. And my understanding is that he was trained in oil painting, you know, socialist realist oil paintings. And then in 1988, he made what will be the first, you'll see a clip from the first video artwork he made called 30 by 30 in a few minutes. And I'd like to ask him why he got interested in video art and started to make that particular work.
I think I've never been a really good student nor a good painter. I get bored, annoyed very easily.
所以那个时候就是，其实，一方面我对绘画已经开始厌倦了，然后我觉得这个绘画里边能解决的问题是很有限的。And
back then I have become tired of painting, and I found that issues that painting can resolve or can deal with are very limited.
我觉得我真正变坏可能是1986年开始。
I probably started to turn bad in
1986.那个时候画了一些手套，然后这个手套其实是用绘画的形式来画一种不太像概念当中的画的画。I
painted some gloves, but the painting was something. I painted it in a way that it's not the kind of painting that people would expect what a painting should be.
同时我那个时候也开始用文字来做作品。And
at the same time, I have been writing as well, so writing has been part of my output.
也做过一个行为，我自己对到今天为止，我还是对这个行为自己比较，怎么说呢，满意的。行为，什么行为？Performance.
Okay, yeah, and also I've been doing some performance as well, behavioral, and it is actually this type of this performance art that I'm more satisfied with, more content.
实际上那个也不是真正意义上的performance，我是从那个中央美术学院，在北京的中央美术学院要到了一个学生的名单，然后呢，我根据这个名单来自己抽签，然后决定。 把这个乳胶手套通过邮局寄给他们，然后里边夹了一封信，一个很简短的说明书。And
it wasn't strictly a performance as such. I got some names from Beijing, the Central Academy of Arts, and then I sent this gloves. 这个手套这个画是不是？
手套的实物。So,
I sent some rubber gloves, along with a note, a short letter. I just picked names, a name, 一个名字还是多个名字？很多。I picked some names, many names.
我寄了三次。And
I posted the gloves, rubber gloves, with a note, to these people, and I posted, in three batches.
那个时候可能就是我刚才讲了，我是一个坏学生，然后也是一个坏的艺术家。其实真的是我不是说故意要把自己说成很坏的，因为我喜欢有点喜欢恶作剧。I've
said that before. I was a bad student and a bad painter. I didn't just say it for the sake of it, because I had always liked pranks. I like playing pranks on people.
我觉得是视觉不一定要是给人看上去是那种能够想到故事啊，能够引起什么伤感啊，能够引起
高兴啊，不高兴啊，我觉得视觉能够，如果是一个作品能够给观众提供，看的人提供一点，就说新鲜的经验就可以了。
I think a visual work does not necessarily has to have a story in it. It doesn't necessarily have to evoke any emotions or sentiments. To me, I think as long as this visual work provoke or bring the audience a new experience, that is enough.
我们每个人都是不断的在受到过去的经验的一种包袱。
We have all of us, every one of us carries the burdens of past experiences. We are the product of past experiences.
刚好那个时候，八十年代末，那么就是电视开始在中国已经普及了，然后呢，也有机会，有开始有便携式的那个摄像机，然后我就想到用这么一个作品，其实也是恶作剧了，拍一个特别没有意思的、特别让人觉得很烦的一个录像。其实我那时候没有想到要做录像艺术，其实也是恶作剧。
And at the end of 1980s, television has become prevalent in China. And at the same time, portable camcorder has also become available. And I didn't really set out to make a visual art as such. It started out as a prank, as some kind of a joke. I wanted to make something meaningless. Just anything.
所以，真的有很多时候，我相信做事情是不小心的。So
I think a lot of things just happened.
So the three works we just saw were, as I mentioned earlier, from Zhang Peili's early video art around the late 80s and into the 1990s. And around 2000, there was a major shift in the form of his video art from works that often engage in repetition, as you just saw, to works that are based on sampling and recutting and montaging other work, ready-mades, if you like, and taking them and reworking them. So the first question I'd like to ask is simply, what caused this change around 2000 to taking sampling from classic films and recutting them?
那个时候，2000年的时候，出现了盗版，就是有很多盗版的这个可以买到。一开始是那个叫 VCD， 后来是 SVCD， 然后是 DVD。
In the year 2000, there started the market started. There were pirate copies of films in the market, at first in the form of VCD, and then SVCD, and then DVD.
然后呢，就是我自己也有了个人电脑。
And I also have a personal computer.
这些片子，我选择的这些电影，这个都是中国的这个老电影，那。 对我来讲是有一种非常深刻的一种记忆。All
those films that I had selected were old Chinese films, something that something in my memory, something that has occupied space in my memory.
有些老电影就是我们在小的时候是反复看，然后里边有一些台词我们都差不多可以背出来。
Some of these old films we watched repeatedly when we were younger, and I could almost remember the lines in it.
刚好在那个时候，我差不多我自己觉得对这个拍摄也有一点点厌倦了。然后呢，就是我觉得那个里边的主观的东西有点太多。我在想，就是说怎么可以想办法从一个主观化的拍摄里边，我能。 逃出来。
And at the same time, I started to become fed up, bored with making films, making things. And I also felt that it's a very subjective thing. All these works contain too much subjective elements in it. So I was trying to take these subjective elements and try to escape from them.
其实这些现成的电影的这个最后重新做编辑的这样的一个作品，之前第一个作品是2000年，我通过网络征集，就是12月31号，世界各地重要的电视台，当地的晚上7点钟的电视新闻。 然后真的很多人给我寄来了，我那个时候是在上海的双年展完成了这个作品，大概是收到了26个还是27个世界各地的录像带，其中也包括中东。是在2000年。2000年，对。12月31号为。对，然后等于说那个是完全是我没有拍摄的那个。 我把寄来的录像带就是原原本本的，就是把它放在那个播放就完了。
In the year 2000, I asked for people to contribute things, materials for me, and the cutoff point was at the 31st of December, and I wanted the 7 o'clock news news bulletin of any place. Anywhere, and I asked people to I tried to collect things from everywhere, and in the end I collected 26 of these things these materials, and they were shown in next year's biennial exhibition in Shanghai, the art exhibition in Shanghai. 是隔年的上海双年展展出来。 然后那个后来我是实际上也是在自己的这个编辑软件上面，我是想学习那个编辑，就是，然后我就把这个我买到的盗版光碟，就是老电影，随便截一段放到那个电脑里边去，然后我拿鼠标随便这样的这样玩移动鼠标，突然发现一个很奇特的效果。
就是在编辑当中，我发现，就是说，你可以把它重新书写。And
then I, at that time, I was learning how to use editing software on my computer, and I bought some pirated copies of these Chinese old Chinese films, and then I was playing around, and used the mouse and tried to move the mouse and see what happened, and then I made some discovery. 你说你这个新的发现。 就是在移动这个鼠标的时候，你这个发现是什么？重新书写。It rewrites things. The software would rewrite things when I move the cursor, move the mouse about.
对，所以又是不小心做出来。So
it was another unplanned accidental
accident. Yeah. Now I have a question, which is, as you've already heard, I think. And you've gathered from what Zhang Peili has been saying, he's very interested in interrogating various kinds of taken-for-granted forms. So, you know, we just saw the taken-for-granted form of the newscast transformed by having the newscaster read out the dictionary. And here we've got the sort of what is now known as the Red Era, the Red Classics of the Mao Zedong era, films from 1949 to 1976. A very particular period of film production in China. And I think many people will assume, perhaps, that there's a strong political motive here. But I'm guessing that, and we've just heard also that it's to do with Zhang Peili's memories of his childhood. But I'm guessing that maybe there's also a formal interest in the style of these films. And I wonder if Zhang Peili could tell us a little bit about whether his motivation in working with this material is mostly to do with style and form from that period, or whether he's also interested in the political content of these films, all of which did have strong political messages at the time.
我想我在那个小的时候，就是观看这个电影，看这些电影的时候，因为那时候很小，就觉得只要是电影都是好玩的，就是没有想到它里边的政治性或者怎么样，因为没有比较，没有看过什么非政治的电影，看不到美国电影，也看不到日本电影，只有这样的电影。但这电影看了多以后，我就觉得。 我不会觉得里边的这个政治性对我影响有多么大，里边的这个台词我们都拿来开玩笑的，小孩经常是模仿里边的人物在开玩笑，所以我觉得就说，我的这个那个时候就是纯粹的是对电影里边的一种模式特别感兴趣。
When I was younger, when I was watching these old Chinese films, I wasn't aware of any politics or any political messages in it, because that was the only thing available to us, and there were nothing else for us to compare. There were no American films, no Japanese films, nothing else. And to me, when I was a child, all films were fun. It was to me they were just fun, and some of the lines in these films to us we often take a mickey out of them. Make jokes out of them. So to me, it wasn't much of a political message in it. And it was the form that I was more interested in rather than the political message.
说句实话，我后来是2000年以后买到这些光盘，我一开始是很惊讶，就是很惊喜，怎么可以这些片子我又重新可以看到了，因为在电影院、在电视里面都看不到了。 所以我就一遍一遍又看这些电影，然后就是我刚才讲的，我在电脑上在玩鼠标的时候，就玩出那个一个很奇怪的效果。所以那个时候我倒是发现，哎，它可以从原来的那种我们讲观看和解读的那个方式里边，又转换成另外一种解读，或者说更多的一种解读。 它变成这个结构上完全是你可以把它打破了，这样打破我现在我吃不准它到底是政治还是不政治。我当时的动机真的就是好玩。It
all started with the purpose of making fun, of creating some fun. And in the year 2000, when I came across all these old pirated copies, it was a pleasant surprise to me because at that time, they were no longer available, not in the cinemas, not on TV, and be able to reacquainted with them. It was a pleasant surprise to me. And I was trying to play around with them and try to break down the structures and see if there were any other kinds of interpretation, any ways of interpreting these work in any other ways. It all started with just trying to create some fun.
As you've seen, for this screening this evening, for example, for the last work, that was originally a two-screen installation work, and Zhang Peili has very kindly re-edited it for us. For some others, he's kindly agreed to let us show clips rather than the whole original 30 minutes or 20-minute work, and so on. So we've made some adaptations, moving what was originally video art, probably you were most likely to find it in a gallery, and moving it into this kind of screening environment. And I'm wondering how Zhang Peili, as he's been sitting here tonight, how he feels about this, this process and this experience of seeing his work moved into what is a more conventional film context.
Uh, 其实我作品当中 大部分的都是那种录像装置，然后这样的单视频的或者说适合在电影院观看的这样的作品真的不太多。然后这次的播放我觉得是我所有以前的播放的那个经验当中这次的效果是最好的。
Most of my work are usually video installations, and in this single screen, single channel format, it's rather rare. But I find that this tonight is what I find the most satisfying of all. I'm the most satisfied with tonight's performance, tonight's this screening. From my past experience, from as far as I can tell from my past experiences.
我觉得这个对我来说是一种很有意思的，也是，很有趣的一种经验。因为一般的来说，我的作品都是在一个艺术的空间里边，美术馆里边播放展出。对，像这样的，像看电影这样的来播放，是不太多的。但是我觉得这个也挺有意思，挺有，对我来说挺有挑战性的。我觉得我刚才就有点担心观众会退票。
Well, because most these works have been shown in art galleries in an art gallery environment rather than in a conventional cinema, and I was really worried. I didn't know how it would turn out, so I was really worried that you would ask for your money back, because it might turn out rather, you might be unhappy with it. But I find this very interesting and quite innovative.
It seems that, of course, we all appreciate this kind of prankster quality in your work. And I'm interested to, I think behind it there's also a certain aggression, which is kind of interesting. There's, as there always is with humor. Humor is always mixed with a certain aggression. Whether the aggression is towards the audience, you know, putting them in front of 180 minutes of somebody smashing a mirror repeatedly and so on, or whether it's an aggression towards the original work and recutting it and you know, repeating it. And I'm wondering if you yourself recognize that there is this element of aggression in your work and what your thoughts are about that.
The 电视文化那些审美的一种观看方式，娱乐的一种观看方式的一种，实际上是一种怎么说呢？是一种发出一种态度，就是我自己是特别不喜欢在任何艺术作品里边直接的来渲染情绪或者怎么样讲故事什么东西。所以我自己觉得是在那个程度上，我在那个时间，就是在一定意义上的确是有一种对习惯了的那种视觉经验进行一种攻击。
I think you were right. In my earlier work, it was in a sense a direct attack on these form of art forms like TV art forms that people have taken for granted. Because to me personally, I don't really like directly emphasizing the sentiments or the emotions in a film. For instance, in a film, the direct expression, direct emphasizing the emotion. So in a way, it was a direct attack on these, if you like.
然后我是觉得后来的，我自己也觉得，就是说这种攻击，一旦最后成为我的一种语言模式的话，我自己觉得这个也是挺可怕的一件事情。
But later on, I also found that when this has become my language, a form of an art form that has become my personal language, it can also be rather scary as well.
我自己还是觉得就是说这个作品在很大程度上跟观众是有一种对话，包括跟西方的观众能够有一种直接的对话，然后是这个对话可能发生什么我不知道，他们怎么来解读我也没有办法来确定，但是我觉得这样的。 对话的提供一个对话的可能性，一个条件，这个是我后来觉得是必须要做的。But
I also find I'm convinced that it is necessary to create the possibility of enabling this conversation between me and the audience. For instance, the Western audience, a direct interaction or a conversation between them. I find it necessary, it is essential that such an environment, such a possibility is created.
And also at the beginning, Zhang Peili also mentioned that this mode of attack he discovered was starting to become a sort of formula in his work. And at that point he got very worried about that and wanted to shift it a little bit. I wonder if Zhang Peili could say a few words about what you see as the most important trends in video art in China today.
Recently, 新媒体还有影像的这个课程专业，所以呢，就是说很多这个艺术家，年轻的艺术家，他是有这种很好的一个专业的一个能力或者说素质，然后现在的年轻的艺术家，他不像我们那时候就是瞎自己瞎折腾，然后有很好的设备条件、技术条件。 然后他们也能在通过网络或者通过各种途径能够了解，国外的发生的情况，在国内也能看到很多展览啊、作品啊什么的。我是觉得就是说，现在的艺术家他们更注意自己的一个个人的这种语言的这种风格。In
recent years, young artists are much better equipped than we were back a few decades ago, because they are they have received proper education in school. There are courses teaching them, be it the technique and other and the equipment and different aspects. They can get information from the internet, and they know what is going on abroad as well. So they are much better equipped, and they have a very good foundation as well. Technique, as far as technique is concerned, so they are. I find that they, these young artists are very much. They are very much concerned. They are very much focused on their own development, their own selves.
他们自己的对技巧。所以我是觉得，就是说，现在从技术和他们的语言的这个，或者说从概念上，他们之间的距离是拉得比较开的。
And because they are more, they put more emphasis on their own, the language, their individual language they use, and therefore they are more diverse and the differences are wider as well.
至少不会像我们那个时候，我像砸镜子这样的让观众难受的作品，是不太会做。At
least they wouldn't make something like 30 by 30 that would make the audience run away. That would never happen again. They wouldn't make something like that.